There are many problems affecting Sabah, actually. The top one would be the issue of illegal immigrants. Not so much illegal immigrants per se, but the illegal immigrants that have been misused by the government for their political purpose. In other words, uncontrolled immigration, the issuance of Malaysian IC without going through the proper procedure. No, backdoor issuance of MyCard, for example. And then later on, putting them on the electoral rolls and deciding who is going to be the YBs, who is going to be the government. So at the end of the day, we find that the government is elected by foreigners rather than by the locals. And eventually, these foreigners will take our local, the rights of the local people. They become Bumiputra, they become natives, and when they are in large numbers, eventually the fear of a reverse takeover will become real. And I think this is the number one problem. The next problem that I think of is the question of recolonization of Sabah. Now, Sabah is an independent country. Sabah achieved its independence before forming Malaysia. Where is the independence now? Sabah has lost its independence, its autonomy. It has become a colony of Malaya. It has become a colony of UMNO. And to me, this is another important issue that Sabah is facing. We have revenues that are being collected by Kuala Lumpur instead of Sabah. We are losing our oil, you know, and along with that is about $15 billion a year. Our revenue amounting to more than $22 billion in all forms of taxes. And these are only revenues that are accounted for. So if you total all this revenue, Sabah is losing something like $37 to $40 billion a year. So part of the problem of poverty is because we generate revenue, but we have no control over our revenue. We have no control over our development. And I can say that we have no control over our policies because we are being run by UMNO, we are being run by Malaya, and our local leaders are mere proxies, managers, if you want to put it that way. The third one would be the problem of land. Our local people, the natives, they have land rights. And these rights have been, have been guaranteed by the Constitution, the federal Constitution, the state Constitution, even by our land laws. But as you can see, the people have become landless, and they have become poor because they have no land. And lands are being taken over by companies, and if they start planting or opening up agriculture in the forest land, now they are being chased out. They plant rubber there, they are being chased out. So the natives are marginalized. And they are not only marginalized, they are poor, disenfranchised, and I think this is the other third big problem affecting Sabah. The 20 points is now part of the Borneo agenda. The Borneo agenda have 7 major thrusts. And the first one is to put up a mechanism to implement the Malaysia Agreement. Because the Malaysia Agreement has not been implemented. It has not been complied with. And the Malaysia Agreement on the Article 8 contains part of the 20 points. And so I would say that if Malaysia is to be successful, the Malaysia Agreement has to be implemented according to what has been agreed, including assurances by Tunku Abdul Rahman, his promises that Sabah is an equal partner to Malaya and will not become the 12th or the 13th state, but it has become the 12th or the 13th state. We have lost our equal partnership. Today we are just a state in Malaya, in the Malaya. I think there is a case to fight for the 20 points restoration, because without the 20 points, there would be no Malaysia. Because that is the condition that was put forward by our ancestors, our fathers of independence, to make sure that Sabah and Sarawak independence, our autonomy, our powers of independence are maintained within a larger federation of nations. So, among the 20 points, which is also guaranteed under the Article 8 of the Malaysia Agreement, powers of immigration, Borneanization, powers to collect taxes and manage our own development, things like that, land, forest, natural resources are all under the state. So the Borneo agenda contains, first agenda is to reclaim back, to restore the position of Sabah as an equal partner to Malaya in the Federation. The second one has to do with the revenue, sharing of revenue. As you can see, Sabah has become the poorest state in Malaysia, even though we are one of the richest states. We should have a potentially 41 billion in revenues, but today we only have 4 billion because the rest are going to Kuala Lumpur. So we want to claim a fair share of this revenue. The same thing with the fair share of our role in the federal government, because the federal government is supposed to be a shared government. The third one under the Borneo agenda is to claim for the restoration of our native rights and the implementation of the guarantee provided under the Constitution. The fourth one has to do with economy, the cabotage policy. We need that to be abolished. We want to implement a system of one country, two system, so that Sabah, Sarawak within the Borneo state can grow according to its own mold and not be subjected to policies that addresses Semenanjung population, Semenanjung problem, but creating problem for us to operate. And this is making Malaysia intolerable. And the fourth one is on this cabotage. We want that to be abolished. The fifth one has to do with development, balanced development. Right now, when they plan for development, it's always Semenanjung first, Malaya first, you know, and Sabah and Sarawak belakang. So meaning they eat first, and whatever is left over, they give it to Sabah and Sarawak. And this is not fair. We want the focus of development to be changed from Semenanjung to the Borneo state. As an example, di rancangan Malaysia ke-10, 10 Malaysia plan, 109 billion budget for development. How much did they give to Sabah and Sarawak? 9 billion between the two states. 100 billion they use in Semenanjung. So 9 billion bagi dua, how much can you get? Bagi lima, how much do you have in a year? So it's not fair. And we need the development more than you have in Semenanjung, because we are way behind. And we need the development so that we can generate the economic activity and also the benefit for the whole nation. That's development. And the sixth one has to do with solving the foreign population in Sabah that have grown bigger than the local population. The legal immigrants is a normal problem elsewhere and anywhere in the world, but in Malaysia, it's the misuse of the illegal immigrants and the uncontrolled of the illegal migrant in the country that worries us in Sabah. And the seventh agenda is to review all federal agencies in Sabah. Many of these federal agencies are there duplicating state agencies which already exist, the same function, like LIGS, LIGM, RISDA, FELDA, FELCRA, when we have SLDB. There's no need to have this duplicating agencies, and they bring the agencies, they bring the people, and then eventually the local agency will die. So we feel that that is not proper, given the fact that we are supposed to be an independent component of the federation. And so these are the seven agendas, and of course it's a very important part of that is the implementation and respect of the 20 points which guarantee the autonomy of states of Sabah. Yes, we are ready to manage the state, and we know what to do. If we have, we are given the mandate, we know what to do, because we have already outlined our manifesto, for example, land, the economy, the revenue, how we, you know, how we will administer the state. We have, you know, of course, we will need the cooperation of everybody. All opposition parties need to get together and resolve the outstanding problems which are being faced right now. We want to make the country better. We want to generate economic activities so that people have better income. We need to generate employment opportunities. We need the people, the native people, to have back, to get back their rights and the land. We need to have a better policy so that on land, so that these people will not be marginalized. We need the, you know, the economy to grow. We need to develop the land, but we want them to contribute back to the country based on the development of the land. We have a lot of economic potentials, but I think this potential needs to be developed in its proper perspective with regard to the global economy, and we need to position ourselves so that we will be able to benefit from the global economy potential, and also develop our technology. Yeah.